three colleagues to speak in this session one in memory of Samuel Skolnikov. I don't know if you've all heard, know about Skolnikov, who's passed away. He's a Brazilian professor who lived in Jerusalem and was a professor at the University of Jerusalem. He was president of IPS and passed away very young. And he worked very much with, I remember the work with the Cratylus and the language in Plato in general. A very dear professor. Just the session is in his memory. We begin with Maicon Engler, who got his PhD from Universidade Federal de Santa Catarina in Brazil, beginning of 2016. He wrote his PhD dissertation on Greek aesthetics, especially Homer, Plato, and Aristotle, and it's and their influence upon German philosophy of the tragic. In 2014, he spent a year doing classical philology in Philipps University, Marburg, Germany. He's published articles, given talks, from Plato to Heidegger and Hölderlin, translated On Virtues and Vices, Aristotle's, and Gorgias' Defense of Palamedes. Nowadays, he teaches in Paraná, it's a state in Brazil, University Unicentro. He's going to present his papers on Plato's interpretation of his own philosophy, Phaedo's testimony on the diaphorá between poetry and philosophy. Maicon, please.
Well, thank you, Marcelo, for the presentation, and thank you all for your presence. So I just mentioned briefly, as Professor Marcelo has already done, that I already got my degree at the beginning of this year, so I'm already a doctor. But I'm here because as I submit my paper, I was still a student. So, okay. I will start reading and make some comments. I would like to show how Plato conceived of his own philosophy in Phaedo as the highest form of poetry. If we analyze this work with care, we can see Plato's attitude towards poetry in a new light. Although many scholars have recently been led to the idea that this attitude is unsystematic and ambiguous, as far as I know, none of them has based his analysis on Phaedo. Normally, they adopt one of the three following strategies. They show that Republic's legislation concerning art is not as severe as it appears and admits of some exceptions. They argue that Plato himself needed poetry to build his ideal city and, a fortiori, to develop his philosophy, in the same way he needed rhetoric to criticize eloquence, as Cicero famously noticed. Or they use Plato's theory of inspiration to counterbalance the supposedly aesthetical asceticism of the Republic and to show that his view has undergone some changes, and that in the time of his youth, he might have seen poetry as the sublime phenomenon it was in the pre-philosophical culture. No doubt, the three strategies proved to have some value. My own interpretation tends to a radicalization of the second position. Instead of using Republic, however, I intend to argue that Phaedo can also illuminate, albeit indirectly, the quarrel between poetry and philosophy, since it allows us to read the whole problem as a kind of undeniable and conscious irony. Furthermore, the testimony of this work also provides a new route to the understanding of every dialogue that comes before it, either in a dramaturgical or in a chronological order. As we know, Socrates' death is usually taken to represent the passage from Socrates to Platonism. The beautiful story about the interest in physics, the swan song, the belief in the mortality of soul, and the doctrine of ideas are compared to the philosophical sobriety of apology and use it to demarcate where Plato's voice starts to sound louder than Socrates. The ideas I will present here speak explicitly neither for nor against this view. They suggest, nonetheless, that Plato's project in the allegedly first phase of his philosophy should not only be found in the aporetic method or in the negative of the knowledge. According to Plato's own interpretation, at least part of it should be located in Socrates' dedication to a sort of philosophical poetry. If this is right, then we could go a step further and say that Plato continued after Phaedo to base the project he had embraced before he wrote it, namely the composition of a philosophical kind of poetry, on a worldview whose design is unthinkable without all elements he took directly from poetry. Even if he might have discovered his own path, he continued to see philosophy's profound kinship to poetry. In doing so, some of the ideas I will present might also contribute to a reformulation of the old demarcation between Plato and Socrates. In order to show these points, let me then start with Phaedo. At the very beginning of the dialogue, Socrates claims that the relationship between pleasure and pain is so curious that a poet, like Aesop, could certainly compose a myth about it. He could say, for example, that a god has joined them together so that one appears, the other comes right after. This little digression, undoubtedly connected with the rest of the dialogue, is the opportunity that Cebes takes to transmit to Socrates a question raised by the poet and sophist Evenus. Having heard that Socrates was dedicating himself to poetry during his time in prison, Evenus was eager to understand the reasons for the philosopher's behavior. Socrates confirms that he had composed a hymn to Apollo and that he was currently engaging in the metrification of Aesop's fables. But, he goes on, Evenus should not worry about any emulation, because in engaging in poetry, he was simply trying to be pious and obedient to a dream he had so many times in his life. In this meaningful dream, poetry appeared to Socrates disguised in different forms and urged him to devote himself to it. Socrates' interpretation of this message is quite revealing. He never tried to write any kind of common poetry, inasmuch as he always considered philosophy to be the megiste musicae. I quote Jowett's translation. "Tell him, Cebes," he replied, "what is the truth? That I had no idea of reviling him or his poems. To do so, as I knew, would be no easy task. But I wanted to see whether I could purge away a scruple which I felt about the meaning of certain dreams. In the course of my life, I had often intimations in dreams that I should compose music. The same dream came to me sometimes in one form and sometimes in another, but always saying the same or nearly the same words. Cultivate and make poetry, make music," said the dream. "And hitherto, I had imagined this was only intended to exhort and encourage me in the study of philosophy, which has been the pursuit of my life, and is the noblest and best music." This is the word in the Greek is megiste musica. "The dream was bidding me to do what I was already doing, in the same way that the competitor in a race is bidden by the spectators to run when he's already running. But I was not certain of this, for the dream might have meant music in the popular sense of the word, and being under sentence of death, and the festival giving me a respite, I thought that it would be safer for me to satisfy the scruple, and, in obedience to the dream, to compose a few verses before I departed. I first made a hymn in honor of the god of the festival, and then, considering that a poet, if he is really to be a poet, should not only put together words, but should invent stories, mythos is the Greek word, and that I have no invention, ouk mythologos, mythologikos, I took some fables of Aesop, which I had ready at hand, and which I knew. They were the first I came upon, and turned them into verse." So that's what Socrates says at the beginning of the dialogue. I believe that we are facing here a crystal clear pronouncement about how Plato understood Socrates' mission, as well as his own philosophy. Against the Aristotelian criterion, according to which poetry is different from philosophy, thanks both to the content it conveys and to its mimetic language, Plato maintains that the quarrel took place because philosophy deals with the same themes that poetry does, and more than that, because it also depends on mimetic features such as myths, images, scenes, and characters. That is why it never occurred to Socrates that he was doing something other than musicae, even if his was a particular form of it. Since for Aristotle, philosophy had a different arena of action in a different language, he could be very liberal towards poetry. No nobleman would fight with a peasant. Much of Plato's acrimony, on the other hand, indicates that he saw an inter pares fight going on, which is to say that he ultimately praises poetry more than Aristotle, as he recognizes its connection to philosophy. This passage also offers a new insight into the way Plato understood the dialogues that he wrote before Phaedo. After all, if Socrates' long life dedication to philosophy was nothing more than an attempt to compose poetry, so Plato's works must be read from a poetical perspective, that is to say, without the modern and Aristotelian separation between these activities. This is in accordance with recent readings of Plato that are open to aspects like the performative arguments of the characters or even the scenario. Ancient authors like Longinus, Proclus, Diogenes Laertius, and modern authors like Nietzsche, Schlegel, have already noticed that Plato emulated Homer in the style of Hesiod's Good Eddies. Plato himself, in the symposium, says that we should imitate and emulate good authors in order to give birth to our own spiritual children. If this is right, then we should consider again the old idea that all minor dialogues should be interpreted on the basis of their aporetic argumentation method. Aporia and refutation certainly cover a large part of the early dialogues. But for Plato, poetry and euporia are also present, as a dialogue like Ion, I will return to this point in a moment, strongly suggests. So I think that there are at least two autobiographical stories in the Phaedo, not only the autobiographic story about physics, but the first one about the way Socrates understood his own mission in relation to poetry. The last point of the passage has to do with Socrates' mission. We can ask in which sense Socrates was doing poetry, since he firmly believed he was. How could he do it if he never wrote anything? Perhaps through his speeches, through his acts. Both cases seem to be right. On one hand, Socrates was doing poetry through his heroic commitment to Apollo's mission, one that forced him to go back into the cave and to remain at his post in the same way Achilles did. His life as a whole is the content of an epic story told by Plato. In order to be the hero of this poem, not only a great poet like Plato was necessary, a piece of good luck that Alexander the Great lacked, but also required were the great acts that led Socrates to confront tyranny, to be a good citizen, a good father and friend, and to face death with serenity. Socrates was doing poetry, therefore, because he was living according to the high standards of the old heroes. On the other hand, these erga were always illuminated by beautiful speeches and conversations. Is it possible to see these speeches as a kind of poetry? In the passage under consideration, Socrates also says that he was working on the metrification of Aesop because he's not a poet, a claim that apparently undermines the identification of poetry and philosophy. Socrates justifies his view by arguing that he's only able to make a speech, logos, whereas the poet's task is to compose stories, mythos. But is this separation between logos and mythos real? Does Socrates really support it? We must remember that before he tells us the story about his dream, he invents a new myth about the relationship between pleasure and pain and shows how he would develop it if he were Aesop. Some pages further, he claims to be inspired like a prophetic swan and then composes a colorfully poetical myth about the afterlife. In other words, the digression on pleasure and pain, as well as many other passages in the dialogues, including the swan song in Phaedo, indicate that Socrates' claim is ironical. For if the ability to compose myths is the criterion of poetry, then Socrates, and Plato of course, is an excellent poet. All these points can be corroborated by other dialogues, especially the ones where Plato develops his inspirations later. Phaedrus presents, for example, a completely inspired Socrates possessed by every kind of divine madness described in the dialogue. That's a paper I'm working on. I can show that more fully other time. The poetic one is found in Socrates' ability to open himself to the divine forces of the idyllic place and to hear the voice of both his genius and the muses. A similar phenomenon occurs in the Ion. Having established that the main feature of an inspired poet is the fluency of speech, euphoria, Plato then depicts Socrates delivering a wonderful and fluent speech about inspiration. As we know, Ion is a rhapsodist who always falls asleep when he listens to any poet other than Homer. According to the magnet analogy, Homer is the only ring that can communicate to Ion the muse's inspiration. Nevertheless, if that's really the case, how can we explain the fact that Ion did not fall asleep, as he was hearing Socrates' speech, but, on the contrary, got even more energized and enthusiastic? It seems that Plato wants to show that Socrates can be a poet as eloquent as Homer, and, in addition, that he's also able to pass along his own enthusiasm to others. Alcibiades and Commio in Symposium gives another hint about Socrates' magnetic power. According to him, to Alcibiades, Socrates' speeches are so powerful that they keep their effect upon our souls even when they are not delivered by Socrates himself, but merely repeated by other persons. That is to say, the Rhapsodes who hangs in Socrates' chains of rings is also able to transmit his enthusiasm in the same manner that Ion does with Homer. One would like to believe that everyone who teaches the dialogues knows this. If we reflect on all this evidence, then it becomes easier to argue that Plato's thought is not so hostile to art. Firstly, he does not throw away a single penny of poetry's treasure, but uses all of it to express his philosophy. Poetry is accepted in terms of philosophical expression, since it's only through images, metaphors, and myths that Plato can awaken us, for example, the experience of the highest lesson of his philosophy, the lesson about the good. You remember, it's just an image that he offers to us. It's an image of the good. Secondly, Phaedo's testimony suggests that Plato was aware of this fact and thus understood his own philosophy as a form of poetry. It was not the popular one, for sure, but his own original and unique form, a rich mixture of every literary genre available at his time. This is why the ancient parallel between philosophy and poetry existed for him. The way he responded to it was not, then, a Puritan attack on poetry, as the lack of imagination with which we read a Platonic text would suggest. On the contrary, as an Athenian nursed in the spiritual environment of Greek culture, and as an enthusiastic ring in the chain of the man who invented irony as a powerful method of philosophizing, he created an incomparably beautiful cosmos, as only the most skillful poets can do. That's all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Maicon. 10 minutes of questions. Thanks.
Thank you. That was a very enjoyable talk. Very convincing. I just have a very brief question. Socrates says, I had always thought that philosophy was the greatest form of music. In which case, why does he then, at the end of his life, practice the modus musica? Why do you think he goes to this apparently sub-philosophical form of music?
I'm not sure why. But there is a big discussion about this issue. For example, Gadamer has a very nice article about that, whose name is Plato as a portraitist. And he suggests that Plato was trying to show that Socrates was not against popular beliefs, for example, which is one of the points of the accusation against him in the apology. So he was trying to show that Socrates believed also in the popular gods, and then he would try to do this popular poetry. But Gadamer says also that it's a kind of irony because he should have chosen Aesop, the fables, and not his Elenchos, because it would be easier to teach people with fables. So I'm not sure, I have no opinion about that.
You want to share?
Thank you very much. I was just wondering about the way you're thinking about to make virtus but not logos. And you're thinking about logos there in the sense of, in this transition here of putting together words. Yes. So logos is language. But it seems strange to contrast mythos and logos as language because, of course, every mythos is language. And it just seems possibly more natural to take logos here as argument. And so they're both linguistic. But Socrates say, because he operates more in argument than an image, that he was not at home in the poetry. So do you think that's a significant
difference
there for what you're arguing?
Okay. Well, I'm not taking this, I'm not assuming this difference, I'm criticizing it. But in the Phaedrus, for example, when Socrates tells the story about the Egyptian god, so Phaedo says to him, "Oh, Socrates, how easily can you invent a new logos?" We normally translate that as myth, but it's logos, the word there. So I think Plato himself maybe did not see a big difference between these two concepts in this occasion, of course. And also because, for example, republic, which is supposed to be just logos, but when they start to educate in imagination the guardians, he says, let's educate the guardians mythologuntes. Let's tell a story about the education of the guardians. So maybe this difference is a modern one or ours. I'm not sure if it's Plato's.
Here, you take the mic. This reminds me of the beginning of Republic 6. This is Socrates. Everybody says, he says, they say, "I don't know how to make images."
Yes.
Beginning of Book 6. It is full of images, how it ends.
Yes.
Well, I like very much your thesis that the parallel between philosophy and poetry means for Plato to engage with the previous poetry and to produce a new kind of poetry, and to mention another passage that probably supports your thesis. I was thinking at the Republic 10, when Socrates introduces the myth of Earth by saying that this logos is not by Alkinos, but by an Alkimos, an head who has survived a travel in the other world. So here there is an implicit contrast with the Homer and your policy.
Yes.
How would you, what would you do with that?
Well, I would say that in many passages Plato is in agreement with Homer, and in many passages he's not, because it's a quarrel, because he considers Homer on his own level. I'm not sure about this passage, but I had this metaphor. It's they are, for example, if you read the Ion and you read the Doctrine of Inspiration in Homer and Hesiod, you will see that Plato is, so to say, sounding the same notes, but with a different timbre. But he has just a different musical instrument, but he's saying the same that Homer said about inspiration, about the lack of subjectivity, about the way the muses act upon our souls. And in the case of Republic, I'm not sure. I'm just not sure about the book then.
Yeah, sure. But, I mean, it's very much in line with what you have argued for, because if
yes,
the carol is an engagement, engagement can be both positive or negative, in the sense that
yes,
criticism is also part of engagement with previous poetry.
Yes, I agree with that. I agree. Yeah.
Thank you.
Carolina first. Please. Yes. Ladies first.
I could do this question later. Thank you, Michael. I just wanted to push you a little further, because it's kind of the same doubts. How do you read? So it says, poien mythos ala u logos, kai autos uk per mythologikos. How do you read the adversity here if both are kind of, as you said, over kind of poetry? How do you understand this adversity, a la u,
Well, I would say that's the same answer, my first answer. I'm not sure. I think that sometimes we can see some difference between logos and mythos, but not all the time.
How would you translate?
I wouldn't translate as put things into word, but maybe with some logic, kind of coercive strength, something like that. I'm not only speaking the kind of Hellenikos I'm used to do. I will not do that. I only know how to do that, and I do not know how to be a poet like Aesop or something like that, which is irony, because right at the beginning he has already made this new myth about Aesop. You cannot find it in the corpus. So I'm not sure if I answered your question, but yeah.
Thanks. One question. Do you think that there is a difference between Platonic paradigm of poetry and the traditional paradigm of poetry? Because your text...
Which traditional? You mean ancient poetry?
Yes. Do you think that...
No, I think not.
Is it the same?
Well, at least if we keep this difference between what Plato says about poetry in terms of mimesis and what Plato says about poetry in terms of inspiration. So you have a kind of doctrine of inspiration. If you read the Apology, Mino, Ion, Phaedrus, you can see some coherent doctrine about inspiration. And then you have the mimetic doctrine, the mimesis doctrine. The first one, the inspiration one, I think it's in agreement with that tradition. You just have to read, like, you read the Invocation of the Muses at the beginning of Iliad and Odyssey, and then you read, for example, Hesiod saying that he was not the inventor of his stories. The Muse taught him how to tell this story. Edidaxe me, he says. And I think Plato is in agreement with that, with this kind of poetics, which still needs the intervention of gods, of Muses. Which is completely the opposite if you take Aristotle, because you cannot find the word muses in the poetics, you just find the word nature, and even Aristotle's theology has this god, which is, I used to say, a ball, a little ball contemplating itself. It cannot do anything in this world. So you cannot imagine a muse coming to this world, you cannot imagine Socrates' genius, sign, because there is no intervention in this world. So I think that this paradigm, the paradigm of inspiration, is in agreement with Homer. Maybe the paradigm of mimesis not, but anyway, Plato uses mimesis a lot in the dialogues. And Proclus, in his commentary to the Republic, says that Plato learned with Homer the whole poietikē pragmateia, but not only the poietikē pragmateia, also the theoria tes philosophies, that he learned also thoughts with Homer. So that's my answer.
We move on. The next speaker, Richard Schorlemmer. How do you pronounce your name? Schorlemmer. Richard. After his Abitur in civil service, he studied Latin, ancient Greek, and philosophy at the universities of Münster, Germany, and Freiburg, Switzerland. He received his master's in 2012, and his thesis concerned with problems of self-movement and theory of soul in Aristotle. He now works on a PhD project on the theories of soul in the school of Aristotle, from Theophrastus to Critolaus. Richard Schorlemmer's paper, The Phaedo Between Orphic-Pythagorean Images and Early Hellenistic Philosophers.
20 minutes plus 10.
Hello, everybody. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for allowing kind of a renegade here who doesn't really talk about Phaedo, but just in passing. And the aim of my paper is, in a way, to delegitimize my being here even further. So I'm sorry for that. But I've got a PowerPoint, which is good, I think. Maybe. It's just to, well, let's say, to underline the myth I am going to present here with some logoi. And the next thing I want to do in preliminary remarks. remarks is that I'm going to skip the whole part about Chrysippus in the paper, as I, well, it would be nice, but I don't think I have the time. So I'll dive right in. Diogenes Laertius tells a story according to which Aristotle was the only one of Plato's pupils who sat through an entire reading of the Phaedo by Plato himself, as we have heard by Gabriele Cunelli in the opening remarks. This anecdote is surely fictional, but we find some support for the claim that Aristotle was a thorough and skeptic reader of the Phaedo. The underlying claim, though, that the Phaedo did not enjoy its later popularity right from the start, seems to have received little attention. It is assumed that there are many readers of the Phaedo in the two or three generations after Plato, since traces of the Phaedo are supposed in fragments and testimonies of the early Hellenistic philosophers. I give you one example by George Karamanolis in his Plato and Aristotle in Agreement. I was nicely pointed to by David Seller yesterday. I give you two interpretations of the theory of soul in Kleichos by Verli and by Verde, who criticizes Verli, who both say that Kleichos was using the Phaedo for a theory of soul, which is a kind of a dualistic one. So there's body, there's soul, and there's nothing else. So there's no mention of the three-partite soul or anything, which appears to be the theory of soul, if he was a Platonist, the theory of soul of the Phaedo and not the Timaeus of the Republic. So there are many more of these remarks. It could well be true that the Phaedo was read by Kleichos and Heraclitus and so forth. I will try to show that it is more likely for at least these philosophers that they haven't taken up my ideas from the Phaedo, but they have taken up ideas from the Phaedo, but just ideas on which the Phaedo elaborates, and therefore do not necessarily belong to the dialogue. Many thoughts in the Phaedo, as Socrates states several times, are not exclusive to the work, but were a product of a cultural, let's say, embeddedness. That is to say that the dialogue took up ideas that were popular and floated around in Athens in many ways during the time of writing. Some of these can be called Orphic or Pythagorean, as Socrates himself does, or as Dorothea Phaedo has suggested. These ideas were surely processed and transformed in the Phaedo, but were in essence not originally Plato's. My aim in the following minutes is twofold. At first, I intend to outline briefly what readers who arguably have read the Phaedo thought were the most prominent points. This analysis will of course be tainted by the small amount of fragments we have, but might give still some insight nonetheless. Secondly, I would like to argue that neither the Stoic Aristotle of Chios, nor Kleichos of Soloi, nor Heraclitus of Pontus have been strongly influenced by the Phaedo. That is, neither of them has taken up any Platonic idea that could not also be explained through a broader, more general point of discussion of the time, so let's say their own cultural context or embeddedness. Concerning the first point, it seems very likely that Aristotle and Strato of Lampsacus from Aristotle's school have read the Phaedo. According to Bonin's, we find 7 allusions to the Phaedo in Aristotle's works. Only one of these allusions is concerned with the theory of soul, but contains no argument or discussion of a Phaedonic idea. It clarifies that it is only the intellect which might be capable of separating itself from the body. One is inclined to read this as a statement of compatibility of the Phaedonic theory of soul with rather different views on the soul, as I've just mentioned in the Republic and Timaeus, and Plato's other works. Other allusions Aristotle makes to the Phaedo only discuss passages which would strike modern readers as odd, because, as Sylvain Le Cominet puts it, il semble qu'il centre de gravité du Phaedon se soit déplacé de l'un à des questions de philosophie naturelle. Aristotle criticizes Plato, for example, in his Meteorologica. I'll give you the example here. For scientifically absurd statements about the myth of the afterlife. He takes it quite literally. This is, of course, not the whole picture. Le Cominet points out that the puzzle whether or not the Aristotelian Eudemus was influenced by the Phaedo remains. Additionally, Aristotle's critique of the soul harmonia theory in his De Anima is certainly a development of Plato's critique in the Phaedo. So while it cannot be said how much and how exactly Aristotle has been influenced by the theory of soul presented in the Phaedo, it is at least probable, to the point of certainty, that Aristotle knew the theory of soul, but only discussed passages he wanted to criticize or clarify. One of Aristotle's successors in the scholarchat of the Peripatos, Strato of Lampsacus, put forth a list of aporiae which directly target the reasoning in the Phaedo. And we've heard that this morning also in Pythagoras' talk. Plato picks up weak spots in Socrates' arguments for immortality of soul and aims at them individually. Against the argument in opposite, for example, Plato maintains that charcoal does not come from wood, that charcoal comes from wood, but no wood comes from charcoal, or ask again the argument from recollection, why no one has ever learned anything without demonstration, or why no one has ever become a pipe or lyre player without practice. Leaving aside intricate problems of transmission, context, and purpose of these aporiae, Strato proves himself to be a very careful reader of the Phaedo. He might also have instigated a tradition of discussion of discussing the arguments if the two fragments on papyri, on which we find an abridged form of Plato's arguments against the soul insomnia, belong to a contemporary or near contemporary of Strato, as David Sackley speculates. I'll skip the rest of page 5, as my page 5, I have no idea, some 100 in the book. And come to the conclusion of the first part. There are other instances of scattered allusions to the dialogue that hint at a lecture, but in general, that hint at a lecture of the Phaedo, but in general, it can be concluded that the evidence for the use of the Phaedo is scarce, and one is not expected to be otherwise, appears to have been selectively, that is, each author picks a passage from the Phaedo and comments, transforms, or uses it to suit a certain point in his own argument. We find the fullest account in Strato, who appears to be in alignment with most modern readers of the Phaedo, who take the dialogue to be mainly about the immortality of soul. I'm coming to the second part now, and skipping Chrysippus. It has further been suggested that Aristo of Chios, Heraclitus of Pontus, and Clearchus of Soloi have read the Phaedo, based on the similar use of imagery found in the dialogue and these authors respectively. In the Phaedo, we find Plato's comparison that it is not virtuous to refrain from one pleasure just to get a different, greater pleasure later. And was quite talked about this passage. It would be equal to trading one coin for another. You need, Plato says, the right coin, phronesis, to decide between right or wrong pleasures. Francesca Alessa now argues that Aristo refers to the Phaedo when he says that virtue is unifold, but can have different forms it presents itself in. So one time, according to Aristo, virtue appears as courage, another time as justice, and so on. It is the same with the drachma. When you use it to pay a captain, you call it travel fees, or landlord rent, or teacher salary, you use the same drachma, but its name differs according to context. Plato, too, compares the phronesis to a coin, but he was probably not Aristotle's source. Aristo says that phronesis itself stays one and the same, where Plato says that phronesis is a means to be traded for the right pleasures. And I thank Catherine Morgan for reinforcing this argument yesterday. Aristo wants to say that phronesis is the only virtue. Plato wants to say that phronesis is a necessary tool for virtue. So the tertia comparationum differ. So neither the wording nor the scope of the argument suggests that the Phaedo as a source for Aristo. And while it is true that Plato hints at the possibility that phronesis is also the unique virtue, you solely need to have all virtues, Alessa's careful article points out that the comparison between virtue and money could as well have been transmitted to Aristotle through other works than the Phaedo. For example, one is reminded most prominently of Apollo's assignment to Diogenes of Sinope to change the political currency which he then misinterprets and just literally adulterates the Athenian coinage. I also may remind you of the talk yesterday where Catherine Moore presented the Euripides fragment for 542, in which arete is called the nomisma for mortals. That was quite a useful comparison as well. Since its image, which might even go back to the Phaedo, obviously not has gone through different forms and elaborations by the time of Aristotle, it is not safe to assume that he has used the Phaedo. Coming to the next one. So, Heraclitus of Pontus was a member of the Academy for many years and even left the school where Plato was in Sicily. It has also been argued that he conveyed Platonic doctrines to Clearchus, because both tried to support their views on the soul with an afterlife myth, just as Socrates did in the Phaedo. According to Heraclitus, a certain Epidotimus stayed behind on Hunt at Noon when Plato and Persephone appeared to him in an epiphany. He then was seized by the light that surrounded the gods and finally saw in visions the truth about their souls. What seems remarkable is that Pluto and Persephone, the gods of the underworld, appear in light and do not live below the surface. Since Heraclitus assigns the place in the souls of the souls afterlife around the Milky Way, Pluto and Persephone most probably reside there as well. This leads to an idea of a heavenly Hades. Traces of this idea can be found in the afterlife myth in the Phaedo, where the souls reside according to the lifestyle in different places, of which one, referred to on Monday, is Ether. But Heraclitus is now mentioned in Sortian Successions, quoted in Diogenes Laertius, and also juxtaposed in the Diotrephes with Pythagoreans on astronomy. Further, Heraclitus appears to have been unplatonic, so it's Platonos on Acoustes, as Proclus says, in astronomical questions. Oh, it's gone again. Well, if you have the book, you have the passages there too, but it's been handy. I think it's coming. When did it go out?
Went out about a minute.
Okay. So I just there's just the
there it comes.
There it is. So I just was talking about the souls in Heraclitus and how he just gets away from Plato, and they are just a text which kind of prove that he isn't really Platonic and especially not Phaedonic in these passages. I think I should continue because of reasons of time. So I'm completely lost now. I'll just paraphrase that paragraph. So what we have here is several mentions of Heraclitus as a Platonist or as a Pythagoreanist and as a not Platonist, if you want to. And so there is an ambiguity if Heraclitus of Pontus has been a thorough Platonist who would abide Plato on every point or would follow Plato on every point, especially of course the theory of soul. Further, Heraclitus, further, Heraclitus calls souls like matter, according to the juxtaphorophes. Although he has been a student in the academy, he appears to have distanced himself from Plato, and, since Pluto and Persephone are mentioned in this myth, used imagery of the afterlife that is less typical for the Phaedo than it is for so-called Orphism. Similarly, we find in Cleitus, a mid-4th and early 3rd century peripatetic, the myth of a certain Cleonimus. Cleonimus was an Athenian with a lively interest in philosophy who grieved so deeply over the death of a friend that he himself lost all his power to live and apparently died. As his mother went to bid him farewell, he awoke and told her and the others at the funeral what he had seen and heard without his body. According to Cleonimus' report, he was lifted into the air after his soul was freed from his body as from fetters, so that he could see the world from above until he reached a place sacred to Hestia, and this place was guarded by divine or demonic powers. Is this wrong again? Just have to listen, maybe. The cloning movement where he's just going to this place sacred to Hestia, after being freed from his body as from fetters, and this place of Hestia is guarded by divine or demonic powers and vague shapes of women. Up there, he met the Syracusan Lysias, and what they saw up there was the chastisement and sentencing treatise of the arriving souls under the supervision of the Eumenides. Later, Cleonimus and Lysias were sent back again, and on their way, they promised to visit each other. When Lysias came to Athens shortly thereafter, Cleonimus recognized him from far away. Just as in the case of Heraclitus, the place sacred to Hestia in the Archer's myth, the judgment of the souls under the supervision of the Eumenids, and death as liberation from the soul from fetters, are also familiar from so-called Orphic-Pythagorean circles. We find, for example, the Eumenides as overseer in the Diaveni papyrus. Socrates says in the Phaedo, as well as in the Crataegus, that the image of the souls liberation is of Orphic origin, and Clearchus himself attributes the view that life on earth is a punishment to the Pythagorean Oxytors. These similarities suggest that neither Heraclitus nor Clearchus have to have read the Phaedo for the imagery, but might as well have taken up ideas that were also found and transformed in the Phaedo from cultural discussions in the 4th century BC. In short, it appears more likely that there is a common source, understood most broadly, including oral, for the Phaedo, Heraclitus, and Clearchus, than a dependency between them as construed in the beginning. Although a definition of what Orphic or Pythagorean means exactly is missing, the imagery of the sources considered to be Orphic or Pythagorean shows sufficient resemblances to Heraclitus and Clearchus. Neither does this imply that Heraclitus and Clearchus were Orphics or Pythagoreans, and that any other Orphic or Pythagorean could be attributed to them, nor does it exclude the possibility that they have read the Phaedo and used one thought or the other without discernible traces. Since the Phaedo itself is a work which was heavily influenced by Orphic or Pythagorean thoughts, it is best, I think, not to see the Phaedo as a source for Clearchus, Heraclitus, and Ariston, but to recognize the Phaedo as a work which was culturally embedded in Orphic and Pythagorean discussions. We then have to estimate these discussions in the 4th century higher, while admitting that the Phaedo in the first generation after its publication was not as influential as it was about to become in later centuries. With Cicero at latest, the Phaedo was understood, as we do today, as a seminal work for body-soul dualism and for Plato's thinking. But in the fourth and early third century, the anti-Platonic anecdote, Aristotle was the only one who sat through an entire reading of the Phaedo, appears to bear at least some underlying truth. Thank you.
I don't remember my details, but But I seem to remember, and somebody probably in this room does remember, about stories about the transmission of Plato's dialogues, like making them public, as if that was something new that happened at a certain point. Do you know that those anecdotes?
No, I'm sorry.
Okay. Well, does anybody here know that? Oh, okay.
Was notable for having a big collection.
And was that something new? I mean, there's some anecdote about that there was something new about them getting out. Like, I mean, just thinking that, like, if they weren't referring to the Phaedo, it validates certain rumors of which I can't remember their source. That when they were disseminated, that was remarked by somebody as if something new had happened, that the Platonic dialogues had been disseminated.
Well,
or am I just wrong about that?
I may point to some sources that, well, back to the third. So there are the two papyri on which we find some abridged form of arguments from the Phaedo. Necessitate in a way that the Phaedo was disseminated and the Phaedo was at least in some parts of the world distributed and published. So I'm not saying that the Phaedo wasn't received at all.
Right.
I'm just saying these three that I look at at least don't need to be influenced by them. Thank you.
Professor Bonaparte, you use in the paper Orphic-Pythagorean or Orphic-Pythagorean.
Yeah.
And I don't know what is your idea about who is Orphism, who is Pythagoreanism, and who is Orphic-Pythagoreanism. Because in this typical Orphic-Pythagorean image, I see the Eumenides are not Orphic. Plato and Pluto and Persephone is not typical, because Pluto and Persephone are really entities in overall. I wonder who is the influence, or in other words, what is the canon according to which you establish a phenomenon as Orphic-Pythagorean or Orphic-Pythagorean?
Yeah, thank you. You're completely right. I need to clarify this. And the first point is, I want to be as non-committal as possible on the question, what is Orphic-Pythagorean, because actually I don't know. I just think that, I just needed a name for the ideas that were certainly floating around and in a philosophical, in a religious context. And I needed to label them. So I just could have said culture. And that. So I'm just saying that there is a cultural context of the Phaedo in which these ideas are transformed. So I don't think there is a canon in any sort. And that this cultural context had its influence on the Phaedo as well as the others. And that these ideas were spoken of in Athens but were not exclusive to the Phaedo. So I'm just saying that I want to make the real minimal case. I have no idea what Orphism or Pythagoreanism is. I just think there are certain elements which can be called Orphic-Pythagorean, so the goddess Persephone, the queen of the underworld, and so forth, which hints at a, let's say, popular religion, popular movement, which presents itself in many different forms as well, and belongs to a culture, as well as a Phaedo belongs to a culture, and that the Phaedo is a product of this culture with ideas that I don't think you can really grasp in the end. I mean, there's this famous statement by Burckhardt that you have the three circles of Eleusinian mysteries, you have Pythagoreanism, and you have Orphism, and all these circles build a common core, but then it's just spread out around the core. And I think is really, really true.
Okay, yeah, good. Thank you, Rika. I wanted to ask you about your passage on Aristotle. I don't have a particular view on any of the subject, but I was just wondering from a methodological point of view. Because you say Aristotle says phronesis is itself one and the same, or Plato says the phronesis is a means to be traded for the right pleasures, and then you again say that phronesis is the only virtue. But that said, that's not an uncontroversial interpretation of the passage. I mean, you referred to Catherine Morgan, and you know that she provides support for that view. But I mean, it seems to me to be problematic in the sense that even if it's the right interpretation, the one you're presenting, it's not the only possible interpretation. And from a point of view of transmission, we could think that Aristotle was influenced by it, but misunderstood it or misrepresented it. And so that what actually Plato meant to say doesn't necessarily have an influence on how it was appropriated. There's not an argument against it being a source for Aristotle.
No, you're completely right. But I think that there's not just the Phaedo that makes this kind of argument. So I've heard you say the quotation by Euripides where the virtue is the phronesis is the one virtue for the mortals, which I think comes very near to what Aristotle says here, and I think that, I want to make the lesser point, maybe, or the smaller point, that you don't need to read that as an influence by the Phaedo. It might well have been, but there are other influences which would or just do as well as an explanation, if you want to even explain this.
Thank you.
Maybe
I wanted to ask you about
Plato's
I want to press on this question of influence, because the way you seem to be reading, I mean, I very much like your general idea that it's drawing from the broader culture, and that there's no necessity of picking up the Phaedo. But I'm wondering, particularly in the case of Heraclides, whether influence might be sort of contrary as well as copying, right? Whether that in fact some of the you might get productive work out of looking at some of the differences in Heraclides as precisely a reaction to reading the Phaedo, and whether you can construe influence in that sort of negative sense in a productive way.
To be honest, I haven't tried that, and I haven't really thought too much about that, because it's not the aim I want to get at. So what I want to get at is to oppose to this kind of statement, like in the first line. So, this being inspired by the Phaedo. So I want just to go against the positive statement. I don't have a solution for that. I don't want to say how the Phaedo now was received in the after Plato. I just have no idea, and I would never say I have. So I'm really trying to make a minimal claim as possible, as minimal as possible, which is just let's not say the influence is, well, Phaedo is the influence on Clearchus. Just that.
Is this working? Yes, I very much agree with your caution, even though I've been cautious about some of these things in the past. But what about Stoic suicide? Because we know that eventually the Stoics were the Phaedo as their biblical text for rational departure from life, which is what they call roughly what we call suicide. How far back, well, we starting with Plato, we know that the Phaedo is the key text. But there's good reason, I think, to trace that right back to the first generation of Stoics, because in particular their interest seems to be interested in this idea in the Phaedo that you should wait, it's impious to kill yourself until God sends some necessity. And so the stories of Zeno's death already suggest that we should follow that canon. So there's a case where I think that this time there are other dialogues of Plato and so on. And it's certainly the dialogues of Plato, which would seem to be authentically about Socrates, were treasured and used by the Stoics. Though you rightly say, following Alison, it could often just as well be the Pythagoras as the Phaedo. What they have to be is dialogues with intellectuals, dialogues without the irrational part of the soul. So the Stoics keep their distance from the public. Let me ask this reason about the suicide.
I haven't come across any sources that would lead me to think that there is an influence by Phaedo in the, let's say, first 100 years after Plato. I think the at least the graspable revival is, I think, with Panagios.
Panagios denied its authenticity.
So he's real.
So yeah.
Yeah. Well, am I wrong? Well, I think at least in the second century AD, right? So I think there is a lecture of Phaedo, and I think there's might be a popularization of the Phaedo, because if we take the evidence from Cicero, Cicero obviously had read the Phaedo, and the Phaedo is for Cicero, well, Plato. So we find the theory of soul Cicero presents of Plato is the dualism between body and soul. Not everywhere, but that surely is, well, Phaedonic, I think. So there is a strong resurrection of the Phaedo again, but I can't say when or where, because I'm not aware then of any sources.
Last one. Yep, please, last one.
Eine Fehlrezeption, eine Fehllektüre, ein absolutes Misunderstanding des Pfeilers, was genau diese Selbstmordeinstellung angeht. Das würde vielleicht ein bisschen helfen, wenn man da noch ein bisschen schützt, weil auch mit den Schulden
Also, das Fragment habe ich mir angeschaut, das ist ja Fragment 23, glaube ich. Da geht, oder beziehungsweise was dort genannt wird, ist ja allein der Titel und das ist dann Psyche.
Genau.
Gibt
es auch eine Diskussion? Aber
genau, ja, das, die habe ich leider noch nicht berücksichtigt. Vernünftig. Genau, danke.
Last speaker, Manlio Fossati, who has received his Magister Artium in Philosophy, Greek Philology, and Latin Philology from the University of Freiburg, currently completing his PhD at the Classics Department of the University of St. Andrews. The title of his thesis is Argument and Scathological Myth in Plato's Phaedo Republic and Phaedrus. He's particularly interested in Plato's argumentative strategies and middle dialogues. The title of his paper, The Soul in the Phaedo, Socrates' Evidence for its Intrinsically Intelligent
Thank you very much for the presentation, and thank you everybody for coming. Scholarship on the Phaedo has been dominated by the interest in the four arguments Socrates offers to convince Simmias and Cebes that the soul will survive separation from the body. Although it has been noted that in his reply to Socrates' defense of the philosophical life, Cebes asks him to show that after separation from the body, the soul will not only continue existing, but also retain, quotation, some power and phronesis, 70b3-4. Little attention has been devoted to analyzing how Socrates addresses the second point of his interlocutor's question. In my paper, I will first discuss how phronesis is best translated in this passage and to what exactly it refers. My proposal will be that phronesis means intelligence and it identifies the ability of the soul to acquire knowledge. The second point of Steve's request is thus for an argument that the soul retains intelligence after separation from the body. I will then analyze the passages of the Phaedo relevant to the question of the nature of the disincarnate soul. My claim will be that, although Socrates does not offer a unitary argument for the notion of the intrinsically intelligent nature of the soul, he disseminates the pieces of evidence in favor of this thesis, of the thesis that the soul is able to acquire and possess knowledge even when it is separated from the body. I will focus on the recollection argument and on the affinity argument. I will argue that the former provides evidence only for part of the thesis Socrates is asked to establish, in that it only shows that the soul is intelligent before incarnation, while the latter, in Socrates' eyes, establishes the thesis more fully by providing evidence that the soul is intrinsically intelligent. In analyzing the arguments Socrates offers for the ability of the disincarnate soul to acquire or possess knowledge of the forms, I will remain non-committal about whether they are able to withstand close scrutiny, but exclusively claim that they are evidence that Socrates embraces the notion of an intrinsically intelligent soul. Before analyzing the relevant passages from the recollection argument and the affinity argument, I will define the notion of intrinsically intelligent soul. As noted, in order to share the hope expressed by Socrates in his defense of the philosophical life, Cebes requests him to provide evidence that after the death of the body, the soul will not only continue to exist, but also possesses some power and phronesis. 70 before. The word phronesis is frequently translated wisdom, but intelligence or reason have also been occasionally used as translators of this word. The translation wisdom could reflect the meaning that the word phronesis has both in standard ethic Greek and in certain statements of the philosophical life. In this section of the Phaedo, phronesis occurs 9 times. 75A9, 66A6, 66E3, 68A2, 68A7, 69B3, 69A10, 69B6, 69C2. And it can be aptly translated wisdom, as it identifies the high level of knowledge the philosopher strives to reach. Despite the meaning the word carries in certain depths of the philosophical life, two reasons suggest that when it is used by Stevens in his reply to Socrates, phronesis identifies the ability of the soul to acquire knowledge rather than the high level of knowledge the philosopher strives to achieve. First, in his reply to Socrates, Sivis makes no reference to philosophers, but he generally appeals to what quotation men fear, 70A1. In formulating the doubt that quotation, when the soul has been separated from the body, it may no longer exist anywhere, and it might be destroyed and perish as soon as it is separated from the body, and that it may be dispersed like breath or smoke, like go fly off and exist no longer anywhere. 60A1-6. Sivis expresses fears that are part of the Greek collective imagery, indication that the concerns voiced by Sivis are presented as embedded in the Greek culture of the period, rather than as felt exclusively or especially by philosophers, is given by the use of the Homeric metaphor of the smoke. As philosophers are not explicitly mentioned at this point, so are they not singled out as a special category in the final part of Stevens' reply? In these lines, Stevens asks Socrates to give him reassurance that the soul will continue both to exist and possess some power and phronesis, quotation, when the man has died. As the subject of the temporal clause clarifies, Socrates is asked to prove 2 points concerning the soul as such and not the souls of people belonging to the particular group formed by the philosophers. Since wisdom is tried for exclusively by philosophers, it would be thus seem inconsistent to think that phronesis in this passage means wisdom. Assuming that Socrates is required to show that the soul will continue to possess wisdom, is also difficult to reconcile with the image of the afterlife depicted by Socrates in the section 80C1-84B8, and in the eschatological myth concluding the dialogue. As both sections consider a wide range of souls different in their moral quality and in the level of knowledge they possess, it becomes clear that the souls are maintained by Socrates to survive separation from the body, regardless of their moral quality and the level of knowledge they possess. If souls with a low level of knowledge are also deemed able to survive the death of the body, it seems inconsistent to think that Socrates seeks to show that in the afterlife, all souls retain a high level of knowledge, despite the fact that some of them have never acquired it. On the contrary, if phronesis identifies merely the ability to acquire knowledge, the notion of a soul endowed with this ability would be compatible with that embraced both in Sibyl's request and in Socrates' description of the afterlife. On this interpretation, it would not be difficult to think that Socrates is asked to show that after separation from the body, every soul retains the ability to acquire knowledge, regardless of the level of the knowledge it has gathered using the ability it intrinsically possesses. Similarly, souls with no level of knowledge can easily be thought to retain after death of the body an ability that they possess but have not used during their life on earth. If it is plausible to translate phronesis as intelligence, Sibyl's request to Socrates can be properly understood as urging him to argue that the soul has an intrinsically intelligent nature. The recollection argument makes an important, although partial, contribution to showing that Socrates embraces the notion of soul such as the one Sibyl asked him to establish. In this argument, he in fact argues that the soul possesses intelligence before incarnation, but he leaves the question of the nature of the soul after disembodiment undiscussed. Evidence that the soul possesses knowledge of the forms before incarnation is given in lines 70-23. Before this passage, Socrates has proven 3 points central to his argument. The form of the equal exists, 74-89-12. It is fundamentally different from the way in which two sensible objects appear equal to themselves, 74-9-4. And it must be known to us before we see two equal sensible things, if we are to notice the difference between the way two sensible things are equal and the form of the equal itself, 74-9-75-83. After receiving Sibyl's approval on each of these 3 points, Socrates is in a position to conclude that the soul acquires knowledge of the forms of the form of the equal before incarnation. Quotation, then it must surely have been before we began to see and hear and use the other senses that we got knowledge of the equal itself, for what it is, if we are going to refer the equal from our sense perception to it, supposing that all things are doing their best to be like it, but are inferior to it. That must follow from what's been said before, Socrates. Now, we were seeing and hearing, and we were possessed of our other senses, weren't we, just as soon as we were born? Certainly. But we must have got our knowledge of the equal before this. Yes. Then it seems that we must have got it before we were born. It seems so. End of quotation. 75-26. In this passage, Socrates first settles that knowledge of the form of the equal must have been acquired before the person made use of sense organs, since, as he and Sibyl already agreed, knowledge of a form must be prior to the perception of a sensible thing that acts as a reminder of that form. He then observes that sense organs start to be used from the moment of birth. Finally, Socrates concludes that knowledge of the form is available before birth. While this conclusion is a crucial step towards proving the existence of the soul prior to incarnation, it also shows that the soul possesses knowledge of the form of the equal before incarnation. If in this passage Socrates' argument is centered on the form of the equal, in the immediately following lines, he clarifies that It is applicable to all the forms. Quotation. Now, if having got it, namely knowledge of the form of the equal, before birth, we were born in possession of it, did we know before birth and as soon as we were born, not only the equal, the longer and the smaller, but everything of, the, of that sort? Because our present argument concerns the beautiful itself, and the good itself, and just and holy, no less than the equal. In fact, as I say, it concerns everything on which we set the seal, what it is, in the questions we ask and the answers we give, 75, 67, 23. In these lines, Socrates generalizes the validity of what he has argued for regarding the form of the equal in the previous passage. Knowledge of not only the form of the equal, but of all the forms, is available to the soul before incarnation. Although providing evidence that the soul possesses knowledge of the form of the forms prior to incarnation, the recollection argument does not, however, establish the notion of an intrinsically intelligent soul. The argument, in fact, does not give any indication as to whether the soul will retain the ability of acquiring and possessing knowledge of the form after separation from the body. If the recollection argument provides evidence that the soul is intelligent only before incarnation, the affinity argument shows that the soul is endowed with intelligence for the entire length of its cosmic life. Drawing two analogies, one between the soul and the forms, and the other between the soul and the gods, the affinity argument contains a passage that openly states that the soul has an intrinsically intelligent nature. When drawing the analogy between the soul and the forms, Socrates explains that incomposite things cannot be dispersed, 78, c3 to 4, always remain in the same state and condition, 78, c6 to 7, and include, quotation, the equal itself, the beautiful itself, what each thing is itself, that which is, 78, d3 to 4. To show that the soul has affinity with this group of things and can be included in it, Socrates offers the following argument, quotation, whereas whenever the soul studies alone by itself, it departs yonder towards that which is pure and always existent and immortal and unvarying, and in virtue of its kinship with it, enters always into its company, whenever it has come to be alone by itself, and whenever it might do so. Then it has ceased from its wandering, and when it is about those objects, it is always constant and unvarying because of its contact with things of a similar kind, and this condition of it is called intelligence. 79, d1 to 7. In this passage, Socrates states that when the soul carries out an investigation alone by itself, unaffected by the disturbance caused by the body and the sense organs, it is in contact with the immortal and unvarying things. As he explains, as at the 78, d3 to 4, the group formed by the immortal and unvarying things include the forms. The possibility for the soul to enter the company of immortal things entails thus that, while carrying out its investigation, the soul comes into contact with the forms and gains knowledge of them. This ability is what Socrates names intelligence. If the assertion that the soul possesses intelligence is a crucial step towards Socrates' stated goal of settling that the soul has affinity with the eternal things, It also shows that he embraces the notion of soul that he is asked by civis to establish. While he argues that the soul has affinity with the eternal things, Socrates in fact also shows that he assumes that the soul has an intrinsically intelligent nature. In the passage quoted, he attributes the possession of intelligence to the soul on the basis of its kinship with the eternal. As he previously explains at 79a2-4, the reason for the kinship of the soul with the eternal is in turn explained with the fact that it is invisible. In showing that the soul has affinity to eternal beings, the affinity argument provides us evidence that the soul is intrinsically intelligent. Thank you very much.
Whether Socrates is willing to prove that's another question, but I mean, that's maybe what Cebes wants. And one thing that may support that use, that meaning of the word in the dialogue, is that when Socrates is talking about his earlier infatuation with natural science, one of the questions he asks is, do we have phronein through blood or through air or fire or various other hypotheses? And that probably sounds like what's our mental life? What's the basis of our mental life or consciousness? You know, is it through blood or whatever? And so maybe that would be sort of a third alternative to think about.
Yes, I certainly would not resist to accept it. Okay. Well, thank you for the question. I certainly would not resist to accept the translation of awareness or consciousness. What is important to me is that, whether intelligence or awareness, we mean by this the ability of acquire knowledge of the forms rather than the condition of a soul that has already acquired knowledge of many forms, because this would, in my opinion, be more similar to wisdom rather than awareness.
Thank you. I also wanted to sort of move along a similar point, and recalling, you know, the motivation for Kevi's sort of concern about this. I mean, the cultural background, to think about the earlier paper, is of course Homer and the underworld, where Tiresias is the only shade, according to this version, who retains nous, right? And so the, you know, the slippage there between nous and phronesis is something that Plato, you might be able to play with there. And sort of, do you think that could help your argument for sort of how to render the sense of phronesis here?
Yes. There is certainly some ambiguity, but a fact I could maybe insist on is that all souls are assumed to survive separation from the body, not only those of the philosophers. So what I think we need here is a word that indicates some characteristic or ability of the soul, or ability that every soul can have, irrespective of the fact that this soul has belonged to a philosopher or to somebody who has practiced philosophy in any way.
Thank you. I enjoyed the video very much. And I think I'm asking a question that continues Professor Jules' question. How do you see the relationship between knowing and the unknowing in your conception of intelligence that Socrates is trying to prove and survives death? And I mean the intelligence in your sense, one that's common to all human beings, not necessarily the philosopher. Because the passage that you take from 79D talks mostly about the soul as light forms, same as them, in the same that they, in the sense that they're eternal, unmoving, the soul when it's with them or grasps them. What then happens to the ability of the soul to think things through, which involves time and going through formal structures and so forth, and thinking things through to itself? Right, the soul talks to itself. Is the soul that you're concerned with one that simply is sort of a place of forms, or does it have an active relation in thinking them through? And that's the continuation. Is it aware of itself thinking through?
Okay. Thank you very much. The point I was trying to make is that. Philosophy is, in my opinion, rather supposed to be an ability, and this doesn't rule out that the ability of acquiring knowledge of the form is also an ability of thinking things through and elaborate the knowledge it has. The point I was interested in making is rather that Florence's insidious request indicates not a condition already acquired and possessed by the soul, but simply an ability which can be used or not used. I don't know if I'm answering your question.
I'm wondering about the structure of that ability. Is it one that involves temporality?
Well, if I remain focused on the Phaedo, I will rather underline its ability of acquiring knowledge of the form, and this is what important for the dialogue. But I would not rule it out that the phrase is. Entails other forms of ability.
I was wondering at some stages of your talk whether you had in mind intelligent as in when we say man is an intelligent animal, dogs, sheep aren't, meaning not anything like an ability to do philosophy, when you talk about not ability to know the form, you're quite close to that. But just an ability to handle basic concepts like the good, small, evil, and good and bad. A text that might support that reading, but I'm not sure, is in Phaedrus, where only souls which have seen forms are qualified to enter a human body. The complication, probably many complications, but one complication is that souls, according to the Phaedo and other dialogues, can enter non-human bodies as well, although when they do that, they don't. Their set of faculties, it becomes normal. But it seemed to me that talking about intelligence as knowledge, ability to know the forms, is setting the bar very high, because there's quite a lot of reason to think that Plato thinks that many people, maybe most people, do not have that ability. That would be the ability to become philosophers. And of course, for the Republic, that's a very rare ability.
Well, I don't know. Probably I would respond by saying that by ability of acquiring knowledge of the forms, I refer to this ability when it is used in the afterlife, basically, when the soul separates from the body and it goes to the place beyond heaven. Then if a soul is able to recollect those forms when it is an incarnate status, it's probably a different question, but a soul, every soul has at least the potential ability to reach the place behind heaven, no matter if it actually does or if fails to do so because its black box is not disciplined enough.
Well, it's not a real question, but I just would like to hear what you have to say, but not on the Phaedo, but on the apology, because we are discussing the capabilities that soul would keep in the afterlife, and in the apology, Socrates says one of the options is that he would be able to interrogate people and continue to do his elenchos. So it seems to me that he would be able to have his full soul in the afterlife, because he would ask people questions about virtue and do the same that he was doing in his life. So I just would like to hear what you have to say about that.
Okay. Thank you very much. Well, by intelligence, I mean at least the minimal ability to acquire some form of knowledge of the, some kind of knowledge of the forms. This ability has been used, it can lead to actual knowledge of the form and to actual knowledge of several forms. And this, I think, would be consistent with the idea of being in Hades and questioning poets and important men from the past.